Coast, who has been a thorn in the side of Whitey Bulger and his gang for 20 years.
Whitey Bulger is a serial killer, cocaine dealer, bank robber, pedophile, very smart criminal.
Did you consider him a worthy adversary? I mean, is that why you went after him so hard?
I went after Whitey just because I couldn't believe he was getting away with what he was doing and that nobody would write about it.
So perhaps it's no surprise that Bulger and Weeks hatched a plan to take Howie Carr out of the newspaper and off the airways for good.
We found out he lived down in Acton, Massachusetts. We drove down his house. We took pictures. We scoped it out. We looked for an escape route. We had one plan. We were going to fill a basketball with C4.
Plastic explosive.
Correct. And when he came out of the house, we were going to blow it up and kill him. But we decided that we'd probably take the house down, too, and kill some innocent people, his family. So we nixed that plan.
Plan B, he says, was much more direct. Weeks was just going to shoot him.
I was down his house one morning, about 5:30 in the morning, across the street in the cemetery with a rifle, waiting for him to come out. And he came out about between 7:15, 7:30, and he had his daughter with him. I assume it was his daughter, a young girl. He's holding her by the hand, going to his car. So I had a pass on it. And then...
Why'd you have to pass?
Yeah, I didn't want to kill him in front of his daughter.
You had him in your sights?
Yeah.
So if he had come out the door by himself, he'd be a dead man?
Yeah.
Your reaction to that?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I believe him or not.
And he says he was in the graveyard. There's a graveyard across the street from your house?
Yeah, there is.
He said he was in the graveyard and had you in the scope. He had you in his sights.
It just doesn't seem like Kevin would have the stones to do it. I mean, I could see if he said Whitey was there, well, you wouldn't be interviewing me because I'd be dead. But I'm just not sure Weeks is capable of that.
He doesn't believe your story. He also said you didn't have the stones to kill him.
Really? Well, I don't think Howie Carr has the stones to confront any man and say what he prints to their face.
What would you say to Howie Carr if he were here?
I wouldn't say anything to Howie Carr. He could tell me what he thinks of me, and I'll show him what I think of him.
And how would you do that, Kevin?
I think I'd be creative. I could figure something out.
Creative? What does that mean?
Whatever comes to mind at the time.
I would assume after the time you spent in jail, you're not going to kill him.
No, but, you know, it's a loaded question.
You can say yes or no.
Well, I don't like him.
For 20 years, Weeks and Bulger were practically untouchable. One reason, he says, was that they had six FBI agents and dozens of Boston cops on the payroll.
Every time we made a score, say there was four of us involved in the score, it would be cut up five ways, and that fifth piece would go to law enforcement, to the connections. And we were always getting information back about investigations that were going on, things people were doing, saying about us, grand juries, things like that.
From law enforcement?
From law enforcement.
Bulger even used tips from an FBI agent named John Connolly to identify and kill informants within his own organization. Connolly is charged with murder in connection with his ties to Bulger's gang. With help like that, they amassed tens of millions of dollars from gambling, drugs, robberies, and extortions. Once Bulger and Weeks even hit the Massachusetts State Lottery, winning $14.7 million, although many suspect they simply coerced the winning ticket holder into having them as partners. Then, in a flash, their luck ran out.
It was 2 days before Christmas of 1994, when a tip from a crooked FBI agent marked the beginning of the end for South Boston's Irish mob. That was the day Whitey Bulger found out he was about to be arrested and charged with extortion and racketeering. Weeks says Bulger knew he had been under investigation, but no one knew how much planning he had done to be ready for this day. Since the early 80s, he had been creating new identities and stashing millions of dollars in safe deposit boxes around the world.
He's probably worth $30 to $50 million.
$50 million?
Yeah.
So he could live a long time.
Yeah.
On that.
Comfortably.
Weeks was one of the few people Bulger trusted enough to stay in touch. He says he was able to meet face to face with the most wanted man in America 5 times over the next 2 years in Boston, Chicago, and New York, delivering forged identifications and keeping him abreast of developments back home. He says the meetings were always arranged by phone.
We had called words for different places. When he wanted me to go to New York, he'd tell me he'd meet me at the Lions.
Where was that?
It was the public library. It had 2 big lions out front.
Bulger told him big cities allowed him to hide in plain sight. One time, Whitey asked directions from a New York City cop.
He walked up to him, and he was looking for a street, a restaurant, and he asked the cop for directions. And I couldn't believe it. I'm just looking at him. This guy's wanted. He just gave him directions and stuff. He thanked him. We walked away.
Weeks says the last time he saw Bulger was in New York in 1996, almost 2 years after he vanished. He says Whitey told him he'd be in touch, but he never called again. A few months later, there was this bombshell. Reports that Whitey Bulger had been a top-level FBI informant since 1975. Bulger, who'd killed anyone he thought was an informant, had all along been giving the feds information about rival criminals as well as some members of his own gang. Weeks, who was still a player in the Boston underworld, was shattered.
He betrayed me. Betrayed me the whole time. Betrayed all of us.
Tell me how he betrayed all of you.
Well, we knew we were paying for information, that we had sources in law enforcement. So as far as we were concerned, the relationship was one way. We were receiving information. We were paying for the information. Now we find out he's given information.
So he was giving up some of his own people?
He was giving up some of his own people. He was giving up the competition. He made a deal with the FBI. They gave him carte blanche to do what he wanted.
Weeks' turn to make a deal came in 1999, when he was arrested and charged with 29 crimes. Facing life in prison and abandoned by his boss, he decided to cooperate.
So what did you do?
We made a deal to sit down and talk. They wanted proof that I was telling the truth, so I led them to 3 bodies.
For years, Whitey Bulger's victims had simply disappeared, and police could never make a murder charge against him stick. Weeks literally knew where the bodies were buried, and he eventually led them to 6 of them. When it was all over, prosecutors were able to charge Bulger with 20 additional counts of murder. In return for his cooperation, Weeks spent just 72 months in prison. He was released last year.
A lot of people, particularly the families of the victims, have been outraged. I mean, they look at it and said, we lost a loved one, and this guy's walking out on the street.
They're entitled to their feelings. I mean, if someone killed a loved one of mine, I'd want to kill them. I wouldn't want them in jail. I'd want to kill them. So they're entitled to, and they're probably correct.
Week says he isn't worried about his safety. He's refused the witness protection program and is already back in Southie, where he says people now know the reality behind the myth of Whitey Bulger.
We were supposed to live by a certain code, and this was his teaching, too. You know, you never ride on your friends, never ride on your family. You never give anyone up. You have a problem, you take it to the street.
You have any idea where he is today?
A definitive idea? No. I mean, I believe he's probably over in Europe somewhere. I believe he went over to Europe, and I think he got trapped over there after 9/11.
And couldn't come back.
Correct.
The federal task force assigned to capture Bulger says the last confirmed sighting of him was in London in 2002. Last week, the task force released this 26-year-old surveillance tape of Whitey Bulger in hopes that someone might recognize his walk or mannerisms.
Think you know all there is to know about getting your cholesterol right? You may be wrong, because getting bad cholesterol down might be just part of the equation. You may also want to get your good cholesterol up. Even more surprising, this cholesterol medicine does both. Crestor. Crestor, along with diet, can lower bad cholesterol by up to 52%. But Crestor also raises your good cholesterol. Down with the bad, up with the good. Is Crestor right for you? That's between you and your doctor. Crestor's not for everyone, including people with liver disease and women who are nursing, pregnant, or may become pregnant. Simple blood tests are needed to check for liver problems. Tell your doctor about other medications you're taking, or if you experience muscle pain or weakness, as they may be a sign of serious side effects. Down with the bad, up with the good. Talk to your doctor about Crestor.
If you're without prescription coverage and can't afford your medication, AstraZeneca may be able to help.
Well, we talk about retiring in Mexico.
Bienvenida. This is wonderful. But would the grandkids ever visit?
Find your perfect place. It's easy with RE/MAX. RE/MAX agents have the experience you can count on to make your dreams a reality. Nobody sells more real estate than RE/MAX. It's frustrating. Just when you're ready to relax, you feel the compelling urge to move, along with hard-to-describe sensations in your legs. They can even keep you from getting to sleep. It's called restless leg syndrome, or RLS, a recognized medical condition. And for many, there's relief. ReQuip, the first and only FDA-approved prescription medication for restless leg syndrome. ReQuip helps relieve the symptoms of RLS. It can help you make peace with your legs. ReQuip may cause you to fall asleep or feel very sleepy during normal activities such as driving, or to faint or feel dizzy when you stand up. Tell your doctor if you experience these problems, or if you drink alcohol or are taking medicines that make you drowsy. Side effects include nausea, drowsiness, vomiting, and dizziness. Most patients were not bothered enough to stop taking ReQuip.
It's good to get comfortable again.
Ask your doctor about restless leg syndrome and if ReQuip is right for you, and help put RLS to rest.
Tomorrow, it's a series premiere so big, we're giving you two new episodes on the same night.
It's an exciting day. You excited?
No.
After a new King of Queens, Julia Louis-Dreyfus stars in the new adventures of old Christine.
Boy, new date night underwear. I think I just got to fifth base.
Then it's 2½ Men, followed by a new episode of Christine.
Hey, Christine.
Looks like the village is missing one of its people.
It all happens on TV's best night of comedy, CBS Tomorrow. And catch Dave on a new late show.
This is a story about an entire city that was taken over by Al-Qaeda. It's called Tal Afar, and about 200,000 people who lived there became prisoners in their own homes when terrorists took control and turned it into their town. They used Tal Afar as a base to train insurgents and launch attacks around Iraq. Last September, U.S. and Iraqi forces set out to recapture Tal Afar, and the Bush administration is pointing to that operation as a model for how to fight and win the rest of the war.
Al-Qaeda in Iraq had a very sophisticated strategy for taking over the city.
And Colonel H.R. McMaster should know. For a year, he served as one of the military's top advisors on fighting the Iraqi insurgency. Yet he says when he came to Tal Afar last May, he didn't realize how badly Al-Qaeda had brutalized the people.
They fired mortars indiscriminately into playgrounds, into schoolyards, across the marketplace to kill innocent civilians. What they really wanted to do was incite fear.
What did that actually mean on a daily basis for the people living there? What was life like?
Life was horrible in the city. They would leave headless bodies in the street. They kidnapped a young child on one occasion, killed the child, put a booby trap inside of his body and waited for the father to come claim the body to kill the parents.
Masked gunmen led by Al-Qaeda roamed the streets of Tal Afar at will, publicly executing and kidnapping people. Colonel McMaster told us some of the terrorists were foreign fighters, but many were Iraqis from the area.
Inshallah, Allahu Akbar.
Pictures of their attacks were circulated in videos like this one, where you can hear them chanting a call to jihad.
They had schools for snipers. They had kidnapping and murder classes that were attended by people on the best techniques.
Were you surprised to learn that it was so organized?
We were surprised. You had this blending of former military expertise and organizational ability with a radical Islamic ideology. And it was fertile ground here.
Colonel McMaster is a soldier scholar, known for writing a book that found fault with military and political leaders during the Vietnam War. As commander of the 3rd Armored Cavalry, he was given the mission to recapture Tal Afar. He told us to defeat an insurgency, you have to win the trust of the people.
The enemy showed the people who they really are. These are mass murderers. These are people who don't respect human life. These are people who want to choke the life out of cities like Tal Afar. Al-Qaeda planted its flag in Tal Afar and said, this is ours.
Michael Ware, Baghdad bureau chief at Time magazine, was able to take these pictures of the city while it was still under terrorist control last summer. This video, which we bought from him, shows Tal Afar had become a ghost town, with the streets deserted, shops closed, and whole families so afraid they stayed behind closed doors.
It sounds as if Al-Qaeda in Iraq could do whatever they wanted to do in Tal Afar.
Absolutely. They owned Tal Afar.
There was nobody to stop them.
No, they were the authority.
Al-Qaeda used Tal Afar as a staging area for fighters arriving from Syria to launch attacks in the rest of Iraq.
Anybody and anything could just move right through the one legal border crossing here.
But that was 2 years into the war. Where was the U.S. presence?
The border was secured to some degree, you know.
Sounds like there weren't enough U.S. forces on the ground to secure that border.
Yeah, I think that's clear.
U.S. forces drove the terrorists out of Tal Afar in 2004, but they left too few troops behind to hold the city. Al-Qaeda came flooding back and took revenge on anyone who'd helped the Americans. Colonel McMaster told us Al-Qaeda's strategy was to incite civil war within Tal Afar's biggest ethnic group, the Turkmen, by using violence to turn Turkmen Sunnis against Turkmen Shiites. When Time magazine's Michael Ware met up with McMaster's forces in August, Tal Afar was so dangerous, the soldiers had to run for cover the moment their boots hit the ground.
In your pictures, we see U.S. forces, and when they dismount from their armored vehicles, they're running.
It was the only way to survive in that city.
Just to get from place to place.
You couldn't even sit inside your tank without being shot.
McMaster expected the bloodiest battle in a neighborhood of the city called Sarai, where Al-Qaeda had its headquarters. To help his cavalry troops, he was relying on thousands of Iraqi infantry, led by U.S. Special Forces.
Let's go!
The troops I were with were what you would loosely describe as the tip of the spear. They were the men selected to go into the worst of the worst. They were to drive the stake into the dark heart of the Al-Qaeda stronghold.
On the morning of September 3rd, the attack began. For the first 3 days, they fought through the city street by street. Whenever possible, they used the rooftops to avoid booby traps Al-Qaeda fighters had planted to slow them down. Frightened families were ordered out of their homes as explosions echoed around them. Those who couldn't walk were carried. There were children clutching white flags. By the third day of fighting, the Iraqi and American soldiers were in place to make the final assault on Al-Qaeda's stronghold. They were taking fire from a nearby building, so American Green Berets called in an airstrike.
They said they were going to come easterly again. Yeah! On target.
We had rounds cracking literally around our heads. The bullets were whizzing in front of me and behind me.
As the fighting continued, the troops were anxious to advance, but they had orders to hold their positions and wait 2 days for more civilians to get out. Then, something Colonel McMaster had not planned for. Politicians in Baghdad forced a delay of 3 more days, apparently concerned about civilian casualties. Michael Ware says to the soldiers he was with, it looked like the delay gave Al-Qaeda time to escape.
The Al-Qaeda presence in Tal Afar was surrounded, and the attack was primed. And then it was stopped dead in its tracks. And so, as the troops I was with battled throughout the day and into the night,
with Al-Qaeda fighters so close you could throw a stone and hit them. When we woke up the next morning, they were gone.
Did it cost you in terms of giving your enemy time to get away?
No.
Your forces were sitting outside Sarai. They were preparing for the big battle. I mean, this was really going to be the fight of the fight. And what emerged was nothing.
What we have to do is we have to be flexible and adapt to changes in the situation. And we were able to do that.
Step right here. Let's go. Hurry up.
When the troops finally entered the Sarai section of Talifah on the ninth day of the battle, they used tanks to blast holes through buildings so the soldiers could move forward without being exposed.
The threat of these IEDs is real.
But after waiting so long, Michael Ware says the momentum was gone, and so, it seemed, was the enemy.
In where an entire Al-Qaeda society had existed, the troops that I was with found one body.
To prove they were not defeated, Al-Qaeda unleashed 12 suicide bombers in a day of bloodshed in Baghdad. They publicly called it revenge for the loss of Talifah, where the U.S. Army calculated enemy dead at 151. 8 Iraqi soldiers and 1 American were also killed. But Colonel McMaster told us using numbers to measure victory is a mistake.
Body counts are completely irrelevant. I mean, what is relevant is the population secure so that political development, economic development can proceed?
So the U.S. military began training a new police force right away.
Let's go, baby!
Recruiting both Shiites and Sunnis to patrol the streets.
What's your name?
My name is...
Schools and markets were reopened. And Colonel McMaster was able to bring together religious leaders who hadn't spoken for months.
Assalamu alaikum, Hajia.
American soldiers, like Captain Jesse Sellers, have taken on added responsibilities. On regular patrols through the city, he's part politician and part policeman.
If she has questions about her husband, she can check at the courthouse, the Iraqi courthouse.
These days, he walks the streets like the Pied Piper, with crowds of Iraqi children chanting his name. They're the same streets he fought for just a few months ago.
You couldn't do this before the Battle of Talifah.
No way. Or at least not without getting in the gunfight. So I'm like...
What does it mean to you to see these stores open?
It's a sign of success. It's a sign of victory, you know? Salaam alaikum.
Salaam.
In the market with Captain Sellers, we met Akil Karaja, a Sunni merchant who just reopened his family shop. He was eager to tell us that life in Talifah had improved.
Could you have talked to me like this when the terrorists were here?
No.
What would have happened?
They would have cut my head, beheaded me.
He said, though, there are still people to fear in Talifah.
This is where the car went boom like that.
Just a month after Al-Qaeda was driven out of the city, his own father was killed in a suicide bombing.
There were enemy fighters that got out and lived to fight another day.
Anybody who wants to come to Talifah as a terrorist, I say, bring them on.
Is and that a yes?
If anybody tries to operate in Talifah, they're going to be
is that a yes, Colonel? Are they trying to come back?
Oh, yes, of course, yeah, the enemy's trying to come back. In an insurgency, there is not going to be a big decisive battle and then the white flags come out and it's over, okay? But what we have here is as close to that as you really can get.
"60 Minutes" is always on CBSNews.com, sponsored by Benefiber. All-natural Benefiber powder, the only fiber supplement that dissolves completely in water and is completely tasteless. Benefiber makes taking fiber easier.
Someday, someone will put together one truly seamless local-to-global IP network. One that works alongside the latest wireless technology. Someday your network will come with every piece of the solution that you need, including the most important piece, people. People who are accountable for your business. Someday, all the pieces will come together, and it will be magnificent. Someday is today. Someday. Verizon has joined with MCI to form Verizon Business. Now you'll look at all your business communications and say, that works. Verizon Business. We never stop evolving, improving, perfecting. We never stop working for you.
If your health not about your skin, this is the natural. Lubriderm Skin Nourishing Lotion with natural shea nut and cocoa butters. It helps dry skin draw in and retain moisture so it's naturally healthy. Lubriderm Skin Nourishing Lotion with shea and cocoa butters.
Get ready for something this refreshing. Introducing Listerine Pocket Mist, the refreshing way to kill 99% of bad breath germs. New Listerine Pocket Mist. Kill the germs, feel the fresh.
We find the defendant not guilty.
The bastard belongs in jail.
You got a body this time, Kim?
They used the same knife and weights to kill someone else before. I thought this case was closed.
Things change fast in Miami.
New CSI Miami, CBS Monday.
Dennis Haysbert stars in television's number one new drama.
Viewers are hooked on The Unit, CBS Tuesday after NCIS.
60 Minutes continues in a moment. Now, here's what else is coming up from CBS News.
Next week, planning your retirement from your 20s to your 60s. Don't miss our ultimate guide to the rest of your life on The Early Show.
On the CBS Evening News, Taking Stock of the War. Tomorrow, we'll begin a special week-long series of reports, The War in Iraq, 3 years and counting.
Julia Louis-Dreyfus stars in The New Adventures of Old Christine, premieres tomorrow after The King of Queens.
At Ford, we believe that you should get more. More peace of mind. So now, for a limited time, the Ford 500 comes with an incredible 5-year, 100,000-mile powertrain warranty. More peace of mind, less worry. Get into a new Ford 500 with $2,000 cash back or a low lease price of just $279 a month. But hurry, these offers end soon. See your Quality Plus Ford dealer today.
The real-world testing we do here at Honda's Safety Research Center enables us to design products that provide exceptional protection for drivers, passengers, and pedestrians. Because what we learn in here makes a difference out there.
An armed robbery involving two 12-year-olds. Details on Eyewitness News after the movie.
There are few issues as hotly contested and as poorly understood as the question of what makes a person gay or straight. It's a political question, a social question, a religious question, but it's also a science question, one that might someday have an actual, provable answer. The handful of scientists who work in this underfunded and politically charged field will tell you that answer is a long way off. But their efforts are already yielding tantalizing clues. One focus of their research is twins. These bedrooms belong to twins who are 9 years old. One room is all camouflage, airplanes, and military toys. The other? Well, see for yourself. A pastel canopy, stuffed animals, white horses. Not all that surprising for boy-girl twins. Except these twins...
With your base coat?
...are Jared and Adam.
I have the Marines parking only. And
when I came for a visit, Jared was eager to show me his G.I. Joe collection.
I have ones that say, like, Marine and SWAT, and then that's where I keep all the guns for them.
Adam, on the other hand...
This is one of my dolls, Bratz Baby. This is made by the company that made this and this.
I hate to interrupt you, but I just noticed you have nail polish on with stars.
And diamonds.
And diamonds. I have to ask you a question. Did you go to school like that today?
Mm-hmm. I just showed him my nails and they were like, why did you do that?
Adam's behavior is called childhood gender nonconformity, meaning a child whose interests and behaviors
are more typical of the opposite sex. Research shows that kids with extreme gender nonconformity usually grow up to be gay. Danielle is Adam and Jared's mom.
How early on did you notice this difference?
About 18 months, he was really into asking for a Barbie. He wanted a Barbie.
At 18 months. And what about Jared? What was he asking
Fire
at 18
trucks. Fire trucks.
Not that much has changed. Jared's favorite game now is Battlefield 2 Special Forces.
What's your favorite game?
It's called Neopets, The Darkest Fairy.
If you were going to tell a stranger what you were like, what would you say?
I'm a kid who likes G.I. Joes and games and TV. I would say like a girl.
You would say I'm like a girl? That's what you would say? Why do you think that is?
Michael Bailey, a psychology professor at Northwestern University, is a leading researcher in the field of sexual orientation.
They've grown up in the same house. They've been treated the same way.
To me, cases like that really scream out, hey, it's not out there, it's in here. There's no indication that this mother is prone to raise very feminine boys because his twin is not that way.
So you don't think it's nurture?
I don't think that nurture is a plausible explanation.
Psychologists used to believe homosexuality was caused by nurture, namely overbearing mothers and distant fathers. But that theory has been disproved. Today, scientists are looking at genes, environment, brain structure, hormones. There's one area of consensus that homosexuality involves more than just sexual behavior. It's physiological.
Bailey and his colleagues have set up a series of experiments in his lab at Northwestern.
The Chicago winters are harsh.
In this study, researcher Gerolf Rieger had gay and straight people sit in a chair and talk. He then reduced them to silent black and white figures and asked volunteers to see if they could tell gay from straight. The idea was to find out if certain stereotypes were real and observable.
She looks quite feminine to me.
He's gay.
This is a man? Already I can see.
He's gay. He's straight.
That was so powerful.
Exactly.
Like me, more often than not, the volunteers in the study could tell who was gay and who wasn't.
So is the conclusion that gay people do, in fact, move differently?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not true 100% of the time. It is true on average. They also studied the way gay and straight people talk.
Hi, it's nice to meet you. Would you like to have a drink?
Sounds straight to me.
And is straight.
Hi, it's nice to meet you. Do you want to go have a drink?
Gay.
This research is controversial, reinforcing the stereotypes, some say. But to Bailey, the stereotype suggests there's a feminizing of the brain in gay men and masculinizing in lesbians. Ironically, though, when it comes to their sex lives, he says gay and straight men actually have a lot in common.
Now, that surprises me.
Well, straight men tend to be shallow in terms of focusing on looks. Gay men are shallow, too. Straight men are more interested than straight women in having casual, uncommitted sex. Gay men are like that, too.
One has the impression that gay men are much more inclined toward casual sex than straight men.
They're just more successful at it because the people they're trying to have sex with are also interested in it.
So that the straight man can't find enough women who would go along. But don't you find this interesting, that the one big area where gay men are more like straight men is in sex? I mean, that is
very
both amusing and odd.
And it suggests that whatever causes a man to be gay doesn't make him feminine in every respect. There must be different parts of the brain that can be feminized independently from each other.
But how and when does this feminizing occur? If the differences were already apparent in childhood, that would point to an early, perhaps even genetic origin. And that's what Bailey and Rieger are testing in a new study using childhood home movies. Here, volunteers were asked to rate each child's femininity or masculinity.
Oh, so girly.
I took the test.
How about a big smile?
And rated both these girls highly feminine. Then he showed me this little girl.
really not girly. Isn't that interesting?
Okay.
She's not girly. I'm going to give him a masculine.
His car's going there, too.
8,693 plus 4 divided by half. What does that equal? Jennifer!
Turns out these physical differences can emerge fairly early. This little girl, she grew up to be straight. This little girl grew up to be a lesbian. The little boy with the gun is straight. And the game show host is gay.
They make spring a lot nicer.
If you can spot a child's future sexual orientation before he even knows he has one, doesn't that prove it's genetic? Studies have shown that homosexuality runs in families, so genes must be the answer. But then the researchers tell you identical twins can have different sexual orientations. We found Steve and Greg Lofts in New York. As identical twins, they had the same upbringing, have the same DNA, and yet Greg is gay and Steve is straight.
When you meet people and they find out you're gay and you're not, what do they say?
Are you sure? How can that be? Yeah, sure. Everyone is curious about that.
There were signs even when they were little kids. Their mother told us Steve loved sports and the outdoors, while Greg liked helping out in the kitchen. But it wasn't until high school that Steve became convinced Greg was gay.
Did you say anything to him or?
I did, actually. I think the way I worded it was something like, you know, Greg, if you're gay, it's okay. I'll still love you the same. And he gave a very philosophical answer. He said something like, oh, I love the soul of a person and not the physical being. And in my mind, I was like, yep, he's gay.
I wasn't ready just yet.
Does this prove that it's not genetic?
What it proves is it's not completely genetic. They have the same genes.
So does that bring us back to the mother and the father?
No.
But that's environment.
That's environment, but that's not the only environment. There's also the environment that happens to us while we're in the womb. And scientists are realizing that environment is much more important than we ever thought it was.
And this newborn rat pup, oddly enough, may hold important clues to what happens in the womb. Dr. Mark Breedlove at Michigan State University says he can take this male rat and make it behave like a female for the rest of its life and vice versa for a female just by altering the hormones it's exposed to right at birth. Because rats are born underdeveloped, that's roughly the same as altering a third trimester human fetus in the womb. But first, he said, I'd need a crash course in rat sex.
He's a Romeo.
He's Romeo. Ooh, look at him.
Male rats like Romeo mount any rat that comes their way. In the mating process, the female, that's her being dropped on top of him, performs something called lordosis, where she lifts her head and rump.
Now, what if Romeo here goes after a male?
The male will seem profoundly indifferent.
But Breedlove says he can change all that. He gave this female rat a single shot of the male sex hormone testosterone at birth. Now grown up, she will never perform lordosis. But this male rat will. Take a look. He was castrated at birth, depriving him of testosterone.
So you created a gay rat.
I wouldn't say that these are gay rats, but I will say that these are genetic male rats who are showing much more feminine behavior.
So this could be the answer to the genetic question. It may not be genes. It could be hormones.
That's exactly the question that we're all wondering, this business of testosterone having such a profound influence. Does that have some relevance to humans?
While biologists look at hormones for answers about human sexuality, other scientists are looking for patterns in statistics. And hard as this is to believe, they have found something they call the older brother effect.
The more older brothers a man has, the greater that man's chance of being gay.
What? Say that again?
The more older brothers a man has, the greater the likelihood that that man will be gay.
Is that true?
That is absolutely true.
Absolutely true?
Absolutely.
If this comes as a shock to you, you're not alone. But it turns out it's one of the most solid findings in this field, demonstrated in study after study. And the numbers are significant. For every older brother a man has, his chances of being gay increase by one-third. Older sisters make no difference, and there's no corresponding effect for lesbians. A firstborn son has about a 2% chance of being gay, and the numbers rise from there. The theory is it happens in the womb.
Somehow, the mother's body is remembering how many boys she's carried before.
Mm-hmm.
The favorite hypothesis is that the mother may be making antibodies when she sees a boy the first time and then affect subsequent boys when she carries them in utero.
You mean like she's carrying a foreign substance?
And if you think about it, a woman who's carrying a son for the first time, she is carrying a foreign substance.
Yeah.
There are some proteins encoded on his Y chromosome that her body has never seen before and that her immune system would be expected to regard as invaders. And
so that's a theory.
That's the theory.
It's still not proved, and it gets even stranger.
One of the things we've only found out lately is that older brothers affect a boy only if the boy is right-handed. If the boy
Wait a minute.
I know. If the boy is left-handed, if his brain is organized in a left-handed fashion, it doesn't matter how many older brothers he has. His probability of being gay is just like the rest of the population.
You can give yourself a headache trying to apply all the theories to real people. Greg and Steve Lofts are both right-handed, and they do have an older brother, so maybe that's why Greg is gay. But they also have several gay relatives, which suggests it could be in the genes. Except where does that leave Steve? Adam and Jared, fraternal twins, have older brothers, but they're ambidextrous. And then there's the question of how something in the womb could affect one twin, but not the other. There are many more questions at this point than answers, but the scientists we spoke to are increasingly convinced that genes, hormones, or both, something is happening to determine sexual orientation before birth. Adam has come up with his own theory.
I was supposed to be a girl in my mom's stomach, but my mom wished for all boys, so I turned into a boy.
Do you wish you were a girl? You do?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think there was anything that you could have done that would have changed Adam?
I could have changed Adam on the outside to where he would have showed me the macho boy that I would want as a boy. But that would not change who he is inside, and I think that would have damaged him a lot more.
This is an interesting question. Are you both proud of the way you are?
Yep.
Both of you. And you're so different.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, are you happy with the service you're getting from your stockbroker?
Oh, sure. I love feeling like a small fish in a big pond.
Service? What's that?
I started investing for myself online at TD Waterhouse. They follow up when I have a question, and they actually make me feel important.
At TD Waterhouse, their investment consultants will give you the attention you deserve, no matter what size your portfolio is. You can do this. Switch to TD Waterhouse, the alternative to higher-priced brokers.
Own one of the most important and critically acclaimed movies of the year.
I will not be deterred.
Next show is going to be about Senator McCarthy.
Do you understand the position you're putting us in?
Somebody's going to go down.
We're going to go with the story. Good night, and good luck.
Buy it Tuesday on DVD. Inside every can of Minwax is the secret to enhancing wood's natural beauty. Minwax rich wood stains and long-lasting protective finishes make it easy to turn any house into a beautiful home. Minwax makes and keeps wood beautiful.
It's built for power. It's built for durability. It's built for strength. It's built for quiet. And it's ranked highest in initial quality by J.D. Power and Associates. Ford F-150. Built with innovation. Built for tough.
8 years ago, this detective went undercover to bust a drug ring, but was a young woman murdered because of his mistake.
Was she your girlfriend?
I screwed up.
CBS Next. He'll get a second chance at justice.
Hey, what'd you do to Ana Castilla?
Who cares?
I did.
A new cold case. CBS Next.
Tomorrow, after The King of Queens, Julia Louis-Dreyfus stars in the new adventures of old Christine.
You have to learn how to swim.
Why?
You can't keep going to pool parties telling people you're having your period.
Then after 2.5 men, it's a new episode of Christine.
What the hell are you doing?
I'm acting sexy.
Looks like you're trying to get a cobra out of a basket.
TV's best night of comedy. CBS tomorrow.
TV's best action and adventure is on CBS Tuesday. First.
We had a ball of beautiful everyone.
a powerful new NCIS.
You're killing everyone.
I'm not the one wearing the bomb.
Then, over 21 million viewers made The Unit TV's number one new drama.
Here we go.
Their missions are invisible.
We're taking fire.
Their lives are secret.
What is he doing now? Sort of a clerk.
Dennis Haysbert stars in The Unit. TV's best action and adventure is on CBS Tuesday.
Hot times in Sub-Zero Russia.
Fire!
New Amazing Race, CBS Tuesday.
At Ford, we believe that you should get more. More freedom with the Ford Escape. Allowing you all the fun you want in a ride with the control that you need. Right now, for a limited time, get a Ford Escape and choose 0% financing for 5 years or $3,000 cash back or a $259 a month lease. See your Quality Plus Ford dealer today.
Puerto Rico. Explore beyond the shore.
Showers and thunderstorms will start the week off. Details after the movie.
There were a few more categories in last week's Oscar broadcast. Andy's.
I always amuse myself by picking some winners of my own during the Oscars. Last year, my winner of the Lowest Cut Dress Award went to Hilary Swank. The winner of the contest for the Lowest Cut Dress Award this year was close. Felicity Huffman was the winner, barely. Salma Hayek wore a swatch. This is Kate Bosworth. Never forget a face. I don't know whether Hollywood dressmakers charge full price when they only make half a dress or not. Someone put together the lowest cut dress in front with the lowest cut dress in back, there wouldn't be much of a dress at all. Kind of funny when you think how different the women dress from the men. Seems sort of sexist. Most of the men wear dull traditional tuxedos. If they dressed like the women, the men would just wear bow ties.
How does the Scotch sound?
My favorite movie was Good Night and Good Luck, but it didn't win anything. Should at least have won for most producers. The credits read, produced by, with one name. Then it showed 8 executive producers. After that, it listed 2 co-executive producers. Then 4 co-producers. What do 4 co-producers produce? George Clooney won for Best Supporting Actor. Clooney also gave the best speech. The award for makeup went to Jon Stewart. He made up the jokes, several of them unnecessarily dirty, I thought. I agreed with Stewart about some things, though. He didn't seem to think he was doing very well as the MC, and I agreed with him on that. This was a good year for mothers. More of the actors than usual thanked their mother.
Particularly my mother and my grandmother. I mean, really, they taught me a lot.
Must have been some fathers involved, but they didn't get much credit for their part. Again, just a little sexist. I'm glad the Oscars are over now, though. Now I can watch myself on television again Sunday nights.
I'm Orly Safer. We'll be back next week with another edition of 60 Minutes.
Want to know a secret? For some adults, today's lunch is A3. And this is what some grown-ups think it means to eat their vegetables. That's why there's Delicious Ensure, a source of complete balanced nutrition with protein, 24 vitamins and minerals, food energy. Have a delicious shake for lunch or as a pick-me-up anytime. So even if you don't always eat right, you can still eat smart. Drink Ensure. Nutrition for a healthier you.
Good news. I got promoted. Better news. I got DirecTV. My new office has a clear view for miles. My DirecTV has 155 crystal clear channels.
I have a $1,700 expense account.
I have over 1,700 movies every month.
I meet with the CEO every Friday. I meet the Fockers whenever I want.
I just got an assistant.
I just got 3 months of HBO, Star, Showtime, and Cinemax for free.
Can you give me the number for DirecTV?
No.
That makes you heard me.
Get over 155 channels for $29.99 a month. That's half the price of cable. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Hello? Remember me? I'm Digger the Dermatophyte, your nail infection.
You may have tried to get me with these over-the-counter surface treatments, but I live deep under your nails. I made myself at home down here, and I'm not leaving. I may even spread out to other nails. I mean, look at this view.
If you have thick, discolored, or flaky nails, over-the-counter surface treatments might not reach the infection. That's why you should ask your doctor about prescription-only Lamisil tablets. Unlike surface treatments, Lamisil is a pill that works through the bloodstream to target and attack the infection at its source, under the nail. In fact, you may start to see clearer, healthier nails in just 3 months. Lamisil isn't for people with liver or kidney problems. In rare cases, serious side effects in the liver or serious skin reactions have occurred, so your doctor may do a simple blood test. Other side effects, including headache, diarrhea, indigestion, and rash, were generally mild. Ask your doctor about Lamisil. It could be your solution. Once daily Lamisil tablets. Get your nail infection where it grows.
The Late Show with David Letterman, all new tomorrow.
Colombia.
Why are you here?
Visiting my boyfriend.
Third time in the last year.
He misses me.
Is this all your luggage?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You carrying any drugs?
No.
Welcome to the United States.
Mentiroso, no, I don't.
Come on,